It's all true, it's all true. Everything they said about you, sing it's all true. It's all true, it's all true, yes. Everything I read, come on, lift it up and say, sing it's all true. It's all true. It's all true, yeah. Everything they said about you, sing it's all true. It's all true. It's all true. Everything I've read,
everything I've read.
The evidence, say, the evidence is everywhere. Growing, I'll testify and I will prophesy. Hey, I'll start rumors up. Sing it again. Sing the evidence. Hey, the evidence, oh, is everywhere. My confidence is growing. And I will prophesy, say you'll start, I'll start rumors of, sing I'll start rumors of my own, sing I'll start rumors of my own, I'll start rumors, I'll tell everybody about you, Lord, yes. I'll start rumors and tell everybody about you, Lord, of mine. Sing, I'll start rumors of my own, and I'll start rumors of my own. Come on, lift up your hands all over the room. Oh, we love you, Jesus. Hey, we love you, Jesus. Oh. There are no words. There's nothing left. And my heart sings to you. Whoa. There are no words. There's nothing left. And my heart sings to you. Whoa. If you know what's in there are no words, oh, there's nothing left, and my heart sings to you, sing, oh, there are no words, there are no words, there's nothing left, and my heart sings to you, sing, oh, hey, there are no words, there are. There's nothing left, and my heart sings to you, sing, oh, 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 there are no words, there are no words, there's nothing left, my heart sings to you, mm-hmm. Oh, and I'll start. housed all rumors of my own, and housed all rumors of my own.
I'll tell them about you, Lord.
And housed all rumors of my own.
Only you know what he's done for you, and you gotta tell everybody you know.
Housed all rumors of my own.
You know the person that you used to be, and he changed you. So you gotta tell him,
I'll start rumors of
your past doesn't define you. He's delivered you from that. So you
start rumors of your own. Oh, and I'll start rumors of my own. Oh, Lord, and I'll start rumors of.
Start a rumor about, like Alicia was saying, your journey of deliverance. Y'all just know what I am. Y'all don't know what I used to be. There's some people that know me before I was Pastor Skip. I was a completely different dude. And there's some rumors out there about me. Some of them are true. Can't deny it. Some of them are true. I did do that. But then I started some rumors.
Yeah.
These hands that I used to swing on, now I lay hands on folk with. Yeah. I started that rumor. God uses me to help heal people. Start some rumors about your God. Start some rumors that he'll turn your darkness into day. He'll turn your mourning into dancing. Hallelujah. Who else can make a mess, can take the mess of a life that you made and use it to change somebody else's life? God, the new rumor is God takes messes and turns them into messages. You are a walking message. The Bible says we are living epistles to be read by all men. Read me now. Do me a favor, go high five three people and say, let's start a good rumor. Come on, let's start a good rumor. Let this go viral. Goodness of Jesus go viral. Let that go viral. Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Man, I missed y'all. I ain't been here since Easter. Lord Jesus de Christos. Yeah, I know a little Spanish. But I'm so excited to see y'all. How many first-time visitors do you have? Wave your hands your first time. Welcome, 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 all of our first-time visitors. Here at World Outreach, we have four imperatives. Help me, family. We do what? Win, man, disciple, and our win is so important. We want you to come to know the God that we are spreading these rumors about. We want you to know him. We want you to know him as a deliverer, somebody who sets free, somebody who's a savior, somebody who will get you out of some trouble you done got yourself into, and turn your life from what seems like a constant L to a great big W, a win. That's what our God does. So after we win, we then mention. Because I understand, just because you're in church, just because your family grew up in church, don't mean you right. Don't mean you good. You have no idea how many dysfunctional folk we got in church. But here we take the word of God, and we just, like a seamstress, we just mend up them holes that life be life in it is eating up in your life. And we patch them up with the word of God, and we show you that there is a way out of that. Then after we mend you, we then begin to disciple you. Because, you know, when Pastor Melvin and I was in Ghana, we couldn't go over there using American rules because they don't work. My son Quentin was in Japan, and he had something in his throat, and he was getting ready to spit. Oh, that's majorly illegal in Japan. You will go to jail for spitting on the floor. So you need to know, what are the rules now that I'm in this family called Christ, now that I'm in this kingdom? Well, here, we freely worship. Here, we trust God. Here, we believe. Here, we know whom the Son has set free is what? All some folks who've been made free by God, make some noise. So we help you understand that. And after you got a good grasp of all that, we then do our fourth thing, which is send you out. And you go out and spread rumors. Hey, listen, you ever seen anybody get free before? This guy, you go out spreading them rumors. You go out and win somebody else and say, listen, and here's the place where I learned how to do that at. So again, help me, family. We do what? Win, mend, disciple, and sing. Amen. So listen, we're going to go ahead and receive this morning's gifts. If you need an envelope, please raise your hand. But we have options. Say, we got options. You can first go to the WOC app, and you can get from there. Or you can text WOC Give. Say WOC Give to 188-364-4483. Again, you got to put WOC Give. Otherwise, some pastor in California is absolutely loving us, because that's where your gifts have been going. So make sure you put WOC Give in there. Or you can go to the website. And just for the record, he know it was a blessing because he never sent it back. He's like, look what the Lord does. He ba 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 ba. Yep, that's it. We sowed into him so God can release into us. But let me say this. We're growing, we're expanding, and we need to get a bigger sanctuary. So we need to make sure you give into the capital campaign. We got to pay this building off, but we also need to make more room. Because we cannot let this space limit the amount of people who need what God is doing here at World Outreach. So are y'all ready to get a bigger sanctuary? It's doable. It is very doable. How many of y'all are ready for a bigger house? Your own personal house. Seek first the kingdom. Take care of God's house, and he'll make sure your house opens up. I'm a witness to that. God has done that on several occasions. So please don't forget. Here's the other thing I want y'all to understand. Giving has to be consistent for you to consistently reap. You have to keep putting seed out there for you to keep having harvest be reaped. And you don't know exactly how powerful your seed is. I was telling people yesterday Friday in Clubhouse. I said, listen, you can count the amount of seeds in an apple, but you can't count the amount of apples in a seed. Let me say that again. You can count the amount of seeds in an apple, but you can't count the amount of apples in a seed. What does that mean? You don't know how big your harvest is once you sow it. Keep sowing, especially if you want to live on a higher level. If there's some business aspirations you have, if there's some raises, you sow and allow God to create a harvest for you to reap from and eat from. Amen? So when you have your seed together, lift up your device or your envelope or whatever you're giving from. Father, we thank you so much for this amazing opportunity to sow seed into your kingdom. And we know, God, that you don't just think seed-minded, but you always think harvest-minded. Thank you that you are not just the Alpha, Father, but you're the Omega. You see things all the way through to the end. And I thank you, Father, that just like when we go and buy some apple seeds in the store, they give us a picture of our harvest. Give us a picture of a harvest for this seed that we're about to sow. Let us see everything that is coming our way. We thank you, Father, that we've made it up in our hearts and minds to be great sowers. And as a result, you've taken the seed, you've blessed it, you've broken it, you divided it, you distributed it, and you've also matured it. And now it stops being a seed, and now it's a harvest. And we go from being great sowers to being great reapers. Say, I am a great reaper. Y'all didn't sound too confident in your ability to reap. That was weak sauce. This time I want you to say it like you know that the minute this seed leaves my hand, harvest is coming my way. Say, I am a great reaper. One more time. I am a great reaper. In Jesus' name. Amen. Do me a favor. Watch these announcements. Then we'll go back to service right after that.
Good morning, WOC, and here are this week's announcements. Men's Fellowship Breakfast, April 20th at 9:30 a.m. Fellas, it's that time again. Come on out and let's join Pastor Skip in the League of Extraordinary Gentlemen for this fun-filled gathering of brothers bonding over some great food and just hanging out. This fellowship is open to all men, so invite or bring your cousins, your sons, your nephews, your fathers, and also your neighbors. And if you know some men who will be interested in coming out, bring them as well. We're gathering at the WOC North Campus. The address is 3410 West Silver Spring Drive, and we do ask you to register. And please, we're asking that you bring a $15 gift to kind of offset the cost of the food. Discipleship wins every Wednesday night to grow in God's word and community by being present for Bible study for that first hour. And then the second hour, we will break out into homogeneous groups. WOC is training up disciples, and this training begins April 3rd.
Marriage Ministry Game Night, Friday, April 17th, 6 p.m., North Campus. World Outreach is relaunching the marriage ministry. So couples, bring your board games in a dish for this fun, packed evening. Games, prizes, food, fellowship. Register today. New Believers Small Group, Sunday, April 21st, both campuses. The Education Department will facilitate a New Believers Small Group for those who are newly saved and new to walking with Christ. This will take place at both campuses, 8 a.m. to 8:45 a.m. at the North Campus and 10 a.m. to 10:45 a.m. at the South Campus.
Around the clock prayer begins families to pray the word for 1 hour, around the clock, at their convenience, on their own, at work, at home, or in their cars, etc. Members are welcome to pray out additional scriptures as well. We will begin this effort Monday, April 1st at 6 a.m. Register to let us know your remote schedule and to receive foundational scriptures.
A Mother's Touch Purple Pajama Party, Saturday, May 4th, 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. South Campus. Ladies, adorn your most modestly playful pajama and be the life of the party.
For more information about this week's announcements, feel free to download the WOC app or go to the WOC website. Thanks and have a blessed week.
Before the word comes, we're just going to go ahead and go back into worship. Are you guys ready this morning?
Say the evidence is everywhere. My confidence is growing. I'll testify and I will prophesy. Start rumors of my own. The evidence is everywhere.
Is everywhere.
Say, my confidence is growing. I'll testify and I will prophesy. I'll start rumors of sing, I'll start rumors of my own.
I'll start rumors of my own.
Sing, I'll start rumors of my own.
I'll start rumors of my own.
Oh Lord, we'll tell the world about you. Tell the world about you. It's all true, it's all true, everything they said about you, and it's all true, everything I've read about you, say, and it's all true. It's all true, everything they said about you, and it's all true, it's all true, everything I read about, saying it's all true, it's all true, it's all true. Everything they said about you, and it's all true, it's all true. Everything I read about you, say it's all true, it's all true. Everything they said about you. And it's all true, it's all true. Everything I read about, say the evidence is everywhere. testify, and I will prophesy. Say, thou sow rumors of my own.
Stand up. If you don't mind, why don't you grab hands with the person or just elbow the person next to you if you're not a hand holder. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you this morning that we can start a rumor about you, but the beautiful thing is that we don't have to have pie in the sky rumors about you. We can pull it right out of the Word. We can look at our own lives and we can put those things together, the Word of God and our experience. Together, Father, we can testify about your goodness. And so today we're so grateful for the opportunity to gather around the Word of God to learn, to grow, to hear what you have to say to us. Father, I'm looking to the Holy Spirit, who you said would be our guide. And so I'm not asking you, I'm saying give me the sensitivity to follow your guiding, because I know that you will always be faithful to do what you said that you would do. And so, Holy Spirit, you're the greatest teacher that I know. And so I'm looking to you today to lead us into all truth, all the truth that exists around what I'm saying. I just yield myself for the voice of the Holy Spirit to speak to me. If there is a truth that you want released, Father, I thank you that I'm sensitive to your voice. The voice of a stranger I will not follow. And so I thank you that every person in this room, we're all good ground. Put your hand on your heart. Come on, put your hand on your heart. I'm good ground. And today the Word of God will come into my heart and I will receive it. I will wrap my heart, my spirit around God's Word. And as a result of me wrapping my spirit around God's Word, I will grow thereby and see the manifestation of God in my life. His word is true. His word is living. His word is activated as I listen. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And that same word that framed the worlds is framing my world. And so I thank you, Father, that we're students of the word. We won't back away from it. And we will be glad that we are in this place today. In Jesus' name we pray. Before you take your seats one more time, embrace the person next to you. Tell them good morning. God bless you. I'm going to ask if you all would. You all, we got to make room. And so what I'm going to ask is if you all, when people are coming in, if you would scooch to the middle or scooch to the ends, if you all that are sitting out, if you all don't mind moving in so that people that are coming in will be able to sit down and we won't have to have people saying, excuse me, y'all know how we do. And so we don't want to inconvenience you, because, you know, as somebody is coming in saying, excuse me, something can be said that has the potential to change your life and you missed it because somebody's rear end was in your face, right? And so we want to make sure that we are scooching in, all right? Everybody scooch. Come on, scooch. Look at the neighbor next to you and tell them, scooch. Come on, let's go. Move in, move in, move in. All right. Want to, before I get in the word this morning, want you all to just pray with me for Linnell Fair. She had a heart surgery this morning at 9 o'clock, and we're just standing with her. In addition to that, Dad Dawson has been placed into hospice care, and we're just trusting the Lord for all of this, you all. Amen. Our faith is out here, and we're trusting the Lord. Nettie Perry, her brother, passed away, as did Carmen's, and so we've got a lot of stuff going on. And so, Lord, we just thank you as a corporate body that we surround our members with faith and love. We ask the Holy Spirit, you are the comforter,
And we thank you that we give you place to be the comforter that you are. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I speak rapid healing to Linnell's body, to your heart, that it will function the way that God created it to function. In the name of Jesus. And Father, I thank you that you will give her the wisdom on what to put in her body so that her heart can regulate the way that it was created to regulate. And Father, we just send love and joy to Dad Dawson and to the family. Father, we thank you, Father, for comforting the family right now. In the name of Jesus, in their time of need, we bless you and we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. And for those of you that don't know Miss Carmen, her brother went home suddenly to be with the Lord, and Carmen is a pillar in our church, and she serves in so many capacities, and her brother's funeral is at the North Campus this Tuesday, and so if you're looking to support or get involved, you can do that. And thank you to everybody that was here for Sharon Jude's mother's homegoing. I have never seen a homegoing like that. It was one of the most beautiful homegoing experiences that I've ever experienced. And so to those of you that came and showed up for that. And then finally, on Wednesday nights, you all, we are cracking the book. Oh, it's been so good. We've been in the Word of God, and then, you know, afterwards we all dialogue about what we're receiving. And Pastor Skip has just been putting so many treasures in us on Wednesday nights. And then at the North Campus, Pastor Tim and Cheryl are doing it. And so if you, you know, you want to grow in your relationship with the Lord, this is how we do it, you all. We sit around the Word. We digest the Word. You look in the Scriptures, there were four things that caused the church to grow, the Bible says. It was the breaking of bread. They ate meals together. The apostles' teaching, the Word of God, prayer, and fellowship. And you all, those are the four elements that make a church community strong. And so we want to be able to provide those things to you all. So when you come here, you're not just sitting in church and then that's it. We want to see you grow. And our desire is when you walk out the door that your life, our life, will impact your life, and then your life will impact somebody else's. Amen, everybody? Amen. And so this morning I want to get into a subject. Last week was, you know, kind of an off subject because of what's going on. But this week I want to get into, back into the message of the priest within. And I want us to start out by looking at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 9. And today I'm going to talk about a priest that loves. Yes, Melanie, I'm talking about the love of God again. Right? We're going to talk about a priest that loves. So let's look at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 9 is where we're going to start today. Y'all praying for me? You believing with me? We're going to get this out? And here's what it says in the King James Version, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 9. I want you all to read it with me. Ready? Read. But you are a chosen generation. Come on. A holy priesthood. A holy nation, a peculiar person, that I should show forth the praises of him who called me out of darkness into his marvelous light. And so to Pastor Skip, the theme for 2024. Every October, Pastor Skip and I find ourselves some way, somehow, somewhere, going to the Lord and saying to him, Father, what is wrong with this microphone? But we find that, oh, I'm sorry, y'all. Is that better? It's too high. I'm trying to bring it low. All right, wait. All right, that's better, all right. And so every year we find ourselves somewhere where we're asking the Lord, what do you want for World Outreach Center for the year that is to come? And so in 2023, we inquired of the Lord about 2024. Pastor Skip came. I was sitting at the kitchen table, and he said, the Lord said it was the year of the priest within. The year of developing the priest within. And so there was things that were going on in his walk. And so as a result of the things that were going on in his walk, the Lord said, now bring the people into this knowledge about the priest within them. And so there's so many aspects of this message that you will receive this year. Pastor Tim is teaching some, I'm teaching some, Pastor Cheryl, Pastor Skip. We're all bringing different elements to this message, but we have to embrace what it means for us collectively as a church body, but most importantly for us individually. What does it mean for you to take ownership of the priest who lives in you? The reason that we read 1 Peter is so that you could see that there is, that you are a priest. You may not feel like it, but it doesn't change the reality that God said that you are a priest, a royal priesthood. You're not just a priest, but you're a royal priesthood. That'll make your back stand up a little straighter, right? You are a royal priesthood, a holy nation. And so we have to embrace what that means for us individually. And so we're grabbing a hold of what that means for my life. Why? Why do I want to grab what that means for my life? Because there are so many responsibilities that lay with the priest. You all want to just give me the other one? Just give me the microphone. Because I y'all going to be signaling in me and talking to me and all of that. Come on, let's welcome those that are watching us live via streaming. Y'all see what's going on? Okay. All right.
Mute me for a hot second.
Right, I'm losing time, y'all. Come on here now. All right, so there are so many responsibilities that come with being a priest. So many responsibilities. And when you look in the Old Testament, you can see that God really valued the priest. But the priest carries enormous responsibility, everybody. And so when you read, we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, you can't just drive by that like you would McDonald's. Yeah, give me a burger and a fry. No, this is something significant for your life. What is it that you're saying to me in this context, Father? I am a royal priesthood. I am a holy nation. What does that mean? And so although we don't have to do everything that the Old Testament priest did because of the sacrifice that Jesus paid for us, God still sees us as royal priests, and there's still roles and responsibilities that he expects us to serve in. It means something to him. Now, I want to give you a little bit of history. In the Bible, when you look in the Bible, we learn about a man named Jacob. And so he's the guy that worked for 7 years to get this woman that he loved. Her name was Rachel. But his stepfather, he worked for 7 years, and after he worked for 7 years, he was supposed to consummate his marriage one night. He goes to bed only for his father-in-law, to do the okey-doke on him. Instead of him giving him the woman that he worked 7 years to have, which was Rachel, he wakes up in the morning and he's in the bed with Leah. How many of you brothers would like that? You work for 7 years for one woman and only to wake up in the next morning and the woman that you worked for, you didn't get her. And so then what happens? Then the father says, well, you know, it's in our custom that you don't marry off the younger daughter before you marry the older daughter. And if you read the story about Leah, the Bible says that she had weak eyes. You know, and it just kind of talks about her and kind of puts her down, like, you know, like there was really no value in Leah. And I'm not going to share the story, but if you go back at the end, you find that Jacob wasn't buried with Rachel. He was buried with Leah. So when it was all said and done, that's another story. Anyway, my point is this. Is that Jacob had to work 7 years for Rachel, then he had to turn around and work another 7 years. So in total, he worked 14 years for Rachel. But what happened was he was having children. Started out, he was having children with Leah after the 17 years, and he didn't have a baby with Rachel. But that third child that he had with Leah was born, and that child's name, they named him Levi. And so why did I share that? I shared that because there was something important about the Levi tribe. So there were 12 tribes, but there was something about the third ones that came into the earth. God's hand was on that third group. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us why he chose that group specifically, but I will tell you this. In the account in the Bible where, you know, they were delivered from Egypt and they go out into the wilderness, the Bible says that, the, you know, this is that situation where you can take Egypt, you can take people out of Egypt, but Egypt you couldn't take out of them. So they get into the wilderness and Egypt is still in them. And so in Egypt, they were building golden calves and all of this. Well, God called Moses to come up to the mountain. And when Moses went up into the mountain to pray, while he was there, he must have been there a long time, because while he was down there, the people were like, where's this guy, Moses? We don't know if a wild animal's come and eaten him. Where is he? And so what they started doing was taking off their jewelry, their gold and their earrings and all of that. And they built a golden calf. Where'd that calf come from? That calf didn't come from that gold. That calf came from within them. It was something that they saw in them. And so they built the golden calf. Moses, while Moses is on the mountain with God, God sees what's going on and says to Moses, you better get down there, because they done built a golden calf. So Moses goes down. He gets down there. He's carrying the Ten Commandments, the commandments that God has given him. And he gets so angry at what he sees that he throws the Ten Commandments at the people of Israel. But here is the significant thing, that before he does it, he says, who is on the Lord's side? That's what I want to know. You're out here building a golden calf. God has brought you out of the wilderness. You've seen miracle after miracle after miracle of what God can do in your life. I want to know, out of all 2 million of you, they say it was 2.5 million people. Of all the 2.5 million of you, which of you are on God's side? And you know who came on God's side? The tribe of Levi. Levi's family is who migrated over to Moses' side. The rest of them stayed on the other side. And so what you see is a faithfulness and a commitment by this group of people. God values faithfulness. God values commitment. And so what did he do? He said, all right, I'm going to take this group and I'm going to separate this group unto myself. It's all the wisdom. I mean, it's all the knowledge that we have about the tribe of Levi. And even today, if you know anything about Judaism, that tribe, most of our rabbis came from the tribe of the Levites. Did y'all know that? God has blessed that tribe. How do I know? Every time you put on a pair of Levi jeans. No. Every time you put on a pair of Levi jeans, that money that you are buying those Levi jeans with is supporting the tribe of Levi. Oh, y'all didn't know that. Yes. The Levi family. The Levi tribe, your genes, you're supporting the priesthood. That's how valuable the priest is to God. Ooh, I can feel the anointing on that. That's how valuable the priesthood is to God. He's going to take care of you. Amen. And so if you know, I shared that was free for you all. But I want you all to understand that it's your role and your responsibility, or what your role is and what your responsibility is as a priest, that it's just as important as the tribe of Levi's was. And what did they value? They valued serving God, and they valued loving and serving people. Amen. And so if you search the scripture, what you'll find that the Leviticus or the Levites were consistently showing their love and support for the people of Israel. And as we look at them, it's important for us to see our responsibility in loving and serving others. Amen. Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 33 and verse number 10. And then we're going to look at Malachi chapter 2, verse number 27. Because in these texts, you find that the Levites were entrusted to teaching and guiding the people in God's ways and in God's word. So when Felicia said today, when I'm in the grocery store, I'm telling people about Jesus, she's operating as a priest. I leaned over to Pastor Yolanda this morning. I called my daughter, who is our graphic designer. I said, I need you, that Kids Zone flyer that's out on social media, I need you to turn that into business cards for me so that when I'm in the grocery store, because I've been doing the same thing. When I'm in the grocery store, I was here at Walmart yesterday, and I met this woman with all of these children, and I walked up to her, and I said, can I help you with your kids? It was an open door for me to begin to love on her and then tell her, hey, there's a place that you can bring your kids where your kids can be groomed in the Word of God. What are we doing? When you're sharing your faith, you're operating as a priest. Why do we share our faith, everybody? Why do you share? Why is it important to share your faith? Because people are broken. It's not just about telling people, get saved or you're going to die and go to hell. That's not what this is about. This is about you taking ownership of your responsibility to get to the hurting and the broken and getting them to the Father. So let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 33, because we're looking at what did the Levites do? What did they do? Deuteronomy 33 and 10 in the NIV. This is God telling them what the Levites are going to do. He offers incense before you and the whole burnt offerings on your altar. Talking about the Levites. Let's go to Malachi chapter 2, verse 27. For the lips of a priest ought to preserve knowledge, because he is the messenger. Look at this. He is what? He is the messenger of the Lord Almighty, and people seek instruction from his mouth. Talking about the role and the responsibility of the priest. Look at it. That's you. Your lips ought to preserve knowledge. Knowledge of what? Of the Word of God. Knowledge about God. Bring it back. And we send pastors to Israel. So there's a group of pastors that are in Israel. I didn't even know that they had gone. And so they're there, and they're in bomb shelters because there is a war that broke out. The war broke out yesterday. There's more bombing that took place yesterday. So immediately I got on the line, called some folks together and said, meet me on the prayer. It was 9 o'clock at night. 9 o'clock at night, I'm on the thing, sending out, meet me on the prayer line. At 9:15, we're praying about those pastors and asking God to get our pastors safely back to the United States. Why? Because I'm a priest. And I understand my responsibility. Are y'all listening to me? When we hear on the way here, someone texts me, Linnell is going into surgery at 9 o'clock. I'm a priest. I put that in front of the priest. And what did we do? I want y'all to hear me. What did we do? We mobilized. Where? In prayer. Why? Because we are priests. Am I talking to the right group? Yes. You're a priest, whether you realize it or not. I read the scripture. I am a royal priesthood. But that's not just for you to wear a badge. There's a responsibility that comes with our lives as priests in the kingdom of God. Amen. Amen. And so, so the priest will pray. And so let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 17 and verse number 9 through 11. And it says this, because this shows the role of the Levitical priest in legal matters and difficult cases. Did I give you? I don't think I gave you that. But if you look at Deuteronomy chapter 17 and 1 Chronicles chapter 9, what you're going to find is you're going to see that the Leviticus, the people of Levi, they oversaw the work of the temple. So whatever was going on in the house of God, the priests were taking care of it. They were taking care of the calls that were coming in for the people.
Oh, I hope y'all hear me. There's a blessing connected with you as a priest when you begin to stand in and operate as the priest that you are. See, when you move over into priesthood, then you remove all of the toil of producing for your own life. When you move into priesthood, then you have an understanding that, oh, my needs, the military doesn't make the people in the military pay for their lodging, their house, their food. They don't pay for that. What happens? The government that called them into service takes care of them. You are in the kingdom of God as a priest and as a king. And so it's not on you to take care of you. It's on the kingdom that you come from to take care of you. So when you move your life into that priesthood state, with that state comes an understanding. Just like God gave the Levites, the tribe of Levi, make some blue jeans. And that will sustain you for generations to come. He will do the same thing in your life. But they were careful to care for God's people. And because they were careful to honor God, to side with God, and to care for his people, God said, I'm going to give you some witty ideas and some inventions. And those witty ideas and inventions are not just going to bless you, Levi. They're going to bless your children's 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 children. And I love it that whenever you pick up a pair of Levi jeans, it says since 18 something, something, something. So since the 1800s, God has been sustaining the tribe of Levi. Amen. They love God. They love the people. They demonstrated service and sacrifice. The Levites dedicated themselves to serving, 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 serving. I cannot overemphasize it. If you're looking for your life to next level, serve. I didn't make this up. What does it mean for you and me? It means that we as priests in the kingdom of God have a responsibility like the Levi family to love God and to love his people. And that's not always easy because people aren't always so loving. You know that saying that faith worketh by love. Well, I'm going to tell you, love works by faith too. Love works by faith. Right? Because some of us ain't so lovable. And it takes a whole lot of faith to love us. Amen. And so when we started this ministry, and I won't even talk about us right now. When you start a ministry or you start a business and you have one goal in mind, and that's to help people, to build people. That God build them into the people that God has called them to be. Give them an experience. You know, we started our car rental business because we wanted people to have an experience second to none. Right? And so when people get in our cars are clean. Our cars smell good. Our cars look good. Our cars ride good. One of our cars, you got massage seats. What are we doing? We want people to have an excellent experience, right? Same when we started the ministry. We started the church. We wanted to pray. We wanted to preach. We wanted to get the word out. We wanted to see people's lives changed. But we didn't come into the business to get conflict. They didn't tell us that there were going to be problems in the ministry. When we graduated from Bible school, they didn't tell us. They didn't prepare us for everything that was coming down the pike. So when you step to serve people, know that there are going to be things that are going to happen that you didn't anticipate. And we've had some glorious years. Don't misunderstand me. We've had some beautiful years.
But when we obeyed God, we didn't expect to have all the problems that we had. And our problems wasn't just with systems. Our problem was with people. We didn't anticipate conflict and disagreements, tension and disrupted unity. We weren't prepared for the many different opinions, misunderstandings, personality clashes, and unresolved people coming in with all these unresolved issues from the past. It's like, I didn't do nothing to you, but such and such a person 5 years ago did it, and you look like them. We didn't know. I didn't sign up for that, but I got it. So you have to prepare yourself as a priest when you're walking with people. Somebody, as I often say, is going to rub your fur the wrong way. We weren't prepared for the lack of commitment. We didn't know so many people struggle with consistency and commitment. We didn't know. I'll be there, and you standing outside waiting. They don't show up. I'll get involved, and I'm not just talking about in church space. I'm talking about in life. So much inconsistency, and we're wondering why we're not producing at the level that we desire to produce. Who plants a seed, you all? We've been talking about this in Clubhouse. Who plants a seed, pulls it up, and then goes back and points at the seed and says to the plant, you're not growing. Well, you uprooted me. How do I grow and you keep uprooting me? I can't get deep enough in your life to produce for you. We didn't know that people would be in and out. We thought for sure that every decision that we made would be met with the love of God, prayer, support. But instead, many were met with resistance to change. Because people don't like, I like this. Don't change this. I'm talking resisting change. Because it makes me uncomfortable, but you don't think about the overall good of everybody. All you think about is how it's affecting you. So when we believed God was leading us, we were met with backlash for new ideas. Don't be introducing no new song. What's wrong with you? We didn't learn that. You introduce new ideas, new initiatives, or changes in practices, or traditions. We be knocking over those sacred cows and cow tipping, and people have a problem with it. Talking about a priest that loves. Then the big ones, unmet expectations, unarticulated expectations. We weren't ready for that. We didn't know that that was a part of it. Are y'all with me? Y'all still with me? We didn't know, and this is for you business leaders as well. People come in with these unarticulated expectations. And so they have these expectations of you because you're the leader. And so they come in with inner hopes and desires that you don't know anything about. And then when their expectations are not met, then they're going to talk about you, they're going to alienate you, or they're going to leave you all together. And you don't have a clue of what's going on. If I had a dollar for every person that said, you don't see me, I do see you, just like I see everybody else. But there's 500 of you and one of me. I'm talking to leaders. See, talking to priests. Amen. Then there's the communication breakdown. Oh, Lord. Misunderstandings, misinformation, conflict, all of it. Right?
Then, of course, Auntie Pat said the gossip and the criticism. Negative attitudes, gossip and criticism within the community that does nothing but undermine trust and unity and morale. But you're called to stand as a priest. Love them in spite of. Walk
Pastor
with
Melvin,
them in spite of. Yes.
Can I add something?
Yep, of course you can.
I think one of the biggest ones is those secret shoppers. They come in to just critique what it is you're doing. They never plan on engaging. They never plan to be on part, but they're going to pick apart everything you're doing. Ain't bringing no God strictly there to see what you're doing and pick it apart and tell you what you ain't doing, and because they've already made a decision that they're not joining, that they don't want to be a part. But now they just got to have a reason to validate why they ain't going to be a part. We all know those. They're wolves in sheep's clothing.
You sound like you've been through something. And so but when you look at the ministry.
I got church hurt.
You got church hurt. Heal him, Jesus. Heal him, Jesus. All right. And so when you look at the ministry of Jesus, what you see demonstrated is exceptional love for people over and above anything else. Right? He loved even at a higher level than the Levites did. And Jesus is our example, right? He's the priestly figure, and he's the ultimate example of what loving people looks like. And so his ministry was categorized by the love of God and compassion, empathy, selflessness. He showed people to everybody, regardless of their social status, ethnicity, or even their background. How do we know? By what he did. You can see it in what he did for people. In Acts chapter 10, verse number 38, the Bible says this. It says, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power. And read that with me. What's after that? And how he went around doing what?
Good.
And doing what?
Healing.
He went around doing good and healing. Doing good and healing all that were under the power of the devil. And why did he do it? How many of y'all in here know God is with you? And so what Jesus modeled for you, leave it up there. That's a spirit of oppression. When you see a domestic violence wherever you might be, that's oppression, right? When you can see the manifestation of darkness around you, that is what you've been called to as a priest, to come in with the wisdom of God, the love of God, the word of God. Because I'm going to tell you something. When God invests all of this in you, just like in the investment world, when God invests all of this in you and it just sits with you, you get backed up. What God has done in your life is designed to flow through you. Everybody say, God, flow through me. God, flow through me. That's his desire for you as a priest. And I know I'm walking through this. I'm not going to push myself through this. This is an expectation that God has of you as a priest. That people that come in your space that are broken, that you are sensitive enough to see it and bring life to it. Amen, everybody. And so you have to love people to want to see them free from the power and the works of the devil. People that don't love others, they don't care about how the enemy is attacking somebody else's life. You can watch somebody go through and do nothing, right? Throughout the Gospels, Jesus is depicted as healing the sick, curing diseases, restoring health to people that were suffering. Come on up, Jay. His acts of healing weren't just limited to a specific group of people, but it was extended to anybody that came to him in faith. And what did that do? That showcased his compassion and his love for people that were in need. We've got to become more people others minded. Some of you are, and I'm going to say it, and I will not say that God did it, the devil did it, the enemy did it, and maybe some of the things that you've done yourself. But some of you are going through some of the things that you're going through because you have not reached out to help somebody else. And you are, Pat called it constipated. You're constipated. Who's ever been constipated? Don't raise your hand. I don't want to see. We all at some point in time have been backed up because we're not investing in someone else's life. All we think about, everything we do, we become consumers. Where all we're doing is consuming what's good for me and mine. And you're not thinking about anybody else. You know, I shared with, I was in Clubhouse this week, and I shared that as Pastor Skip and I were preparing our taxes this year, we sow personally, we sow nationally, locally, and globally. Well, this year, we did not sow what we generally sow. And our goal is every year to increase how much we're sowing out. We have a desire. Our ultimate desire is to give away 80% of our income and live off of 20%. That's the goal that we've been working on since we got married. And so when we looked at our giving this year, it was like, where did we miss it? Well, there's some things that we, you know, that happened with the business, and so a lot of money went in that direction, but then there were other things that were going on that we invested in. But we had to get back to the base. Have you been pouring out so that someone else's life can be increased? And if you haven't, that might be the starting point of why you're experiencing some of the things that you experience, because the law of reciprocity works, you all. If you sow, you will reap. It's a law. And what God will never do is violate that law. If you sow, you have a right to expect a harvest. And as a priest that loves others, every day should be about how can I increase somebody else's life? What can I do to make life better for someone else? Are y'all with me today? And I know that you're not hanging off the rafters in what I'm saying. But this is like the meat and the potatoes of our lives. These are critical conversations that we have to have with believers, because as believers, when we get to Mark 11, 23, 24, and 25, that says, whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that the things that he says, he'll have whatever he says. So we're all looking at the mountains and decreeing and declaring what we want from the mountain. And we get so consumed with using the word of God just for our own lives that we forget that that's not the way God operates. When he raises you up, the intent is for you then to turn around and raise up somebody else. And so you have to ask yourself, am I going through what I'm going through because I failed to give myself to somebody else or to something else? The law of reciprocity works. And if you're not sowing, you cannot reap. It's an impossibility. And something that we brought out this week is that inside every seed, Pastor Skip's statement about, how did you say that about the apple and the seeds? What did you say? You can't.
Check one. You cannot, you can count the amount of seeds in an apple, but you cannot count the amount of apples in a seed.
You can't count the amount of apples in a seed. What that means for you and me is that you have a rich potential for harvest. That's what that means. It means that when you begin to sow, you have no idea how increase will come into your life. In Genesis, the word of God says this. It's a statement that none of us should ever forget. Let the earth produce seed, grass, herb yielding seed, and fruit and seed. But then he says this, whose seed is in it self. Inside the fruit is the seed itself. In other words, the ability for that seed to reproduce itself over and over and over again lies in that seed. And when you understand that, you will be intentional about sowing your life, sowing your resources, sowing your time into somebody else's life, because it's going to produce a harvest for you. Now grab Ecclesiastes, where he said, cast your bread upon the waters, and in not many days it will come back. He said, send it out seven ways. No, send it out eight. That's what the Bible says. Because you don't know where the tree is going to land. In other words, you don't know where the harvest is going to come from. Maybe it's going to come from this way. Maybe it's going to come. But you've got seven streams guaranteed. Seven to eight ways that God will bring increase back to your life. Does that bless you? Everybody stand up. Put up John chapter 13. Come on up, Pastor Skip. John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35. John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35. In the Message Bible is what he said this. Let me give you a new command. Love one another. In the same way I have loved you, you love one another. This is how everyone will know. They will recognize that you are my disciples. When they see, come on, the love you have for each other. And so your love in action is what's your love in action is what's going to show the world that you are a disciple of Jesus Christ. Then, you know, then bring up 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 12 in the Message. Because it's important for you all to understand that you are hardwired for love. You're hardwired for love.